Welcome to 700 Club Interactive. More than 1 million homes were foreclosed on in 2010. That's certainly a sign our real estate crisis is far from over. However, there is life after foreclosure, and our experts will be with us today. Bethany and Scott Palmer will be here to tell us more. First, Andrea Garrett has more on America's housing dilemma.
Banks repossessed 1 million homes in 2010, the worst year since the mortgage crisis began 4 years ago. One in 45 households received a foreclosure filing last year. More than 15 million homeowners currently owe more on their mortgages than their homes are worth, a condition known as being underwater. And around 5 million borrowers are at least 2 months behind on their mortgage payments. The areas hardest hit by the mortgage meltdown are Nevada, Arizona, California, and Florida. Las Vegas takes the lead with more than 81% of all properties showing negative equity. Many would-be buyers are staying away from the housing market because of high unemployment, tight lending standards, and uncertainty about prices. And analysts say 2011 will be even worse. Some expect that this year will mark the bottom of the real estate collapse.
Well, please welcome back to 700 Club Interactive the authors of First Comes Love, Then Comes Money, Bethany and Scott Palmer. Bethany and Scott, welcome.
Thank you for having us.
It's great to be here.
What would you tell somebody who's upside down on their mortgage right now?
Stay put. This is definitely not the time to sell. Start talking about it and working on it and just be really honest with each other about that. But right now, if you can stay in that home, stay in that home.
And one of the things that we found is foreclosures is putting so much pressure on relationships. And we have seen that over and over again. You know, a financial relationship isn't just your financial plan. It's how and you make decisions about things where money is involved. And when you have really stressful decisions that have to be made, especially when it comes to the decision about a foreclosure, that plays havoc on your relationship. And place havoc on your financial relationship. So we really have to be intentional about our relationship as we're looking at this event that happened, and it's really, really tough. So how do you do that?
Bethany, what would you tell couples that are going through it? I don't think anybody wants to go through a foreclosure. It's not, you know, like something you wake up and say, well, I want to be foreclosed on today.
No, absolutely not. And we.
What do you do?
Sure. There's really four things that you can do to work through your relationship as it pertains to the foreclosure. First of all, what we want to do is grieve the loss. This is a big loss for a couple. And it's you go through all the stages that you do in a death of a human, in the sense of it's obviously not as catastrophic of a death of a human, but it plays that much havoc on the relationship. So acknowledging it and not just trying to duck, but acknowledging that that reality is there.
The second one you want to do is avoid the blame game. When we see couples that are so heightened with this financial stress of a foreclosure or going into a foreclosure, it is not the time to begin to start guessing what you've done in the past, start talking about, hey, you could have gotten a better job, we should have done this, we should have done that. It is not the time to put the blame game, because the minute you start to do this blame game, you are going to create an amazing wedge in that relationship financially. And we're finding that a lot of these foreclosures are leading people down a very scary path and towards divorce. So you really have to stop. If you start the blame game, stop it. Apologize to each other. It is what it is.
It is. The third thing that you want to do is decide who you are going to tell. Who in the family, who outside of the family, if you don't agree on that, you can have some really uncomfortable situations. We had a situation not all that long ago where a couple got divorced and the wife told all of her friends in her Bible study group, and then it got out. And it was really an embarrassing kind of situation,
the foreclosure
of what happened with that. So how important it is to make sure that getting on the same page as to who you're going to tell and who you're going to tell in the family. Because not everybody in the family, maybe, you know, Aunt Susie tells a lot of people things that are personal. So you really have to decide together who you're going to tell.
How would you advise couples to just deal with the humiliation factor? that it's more than just who you tell, but sort of how you tell. And
absolutely,
it's obviously a financial failure and certainly a sign of financial distress. How do you deal with just the humiliation?
It's a very humbling experience. And that's why talking together and deciding who you're going to tell is important. And the way that you tell is you put it out there. If you feel that there's a person that that's important to tell, then you have to be honest and just tell it like it is. There's some circumstances in our life that led us down the path of having to get a foreclosure, and we're trying to get on the other end, but please pray for us and help us work through this situation together. And we really need your support. People often want to know when there's a challenging situation like a foreclosure, they want to know how they can help. And that's the most important message to give, is action steps of things that they can do. We need your support. Check in with us, see how we're doing, and then move on from there.
All right, after the foreclosure, assuming that the couple's still together and the family's still intact, what do they do to just get back on their feet?
Well, I think we talk about the fourth step, which is take some time off. You need to come down a notch. So going and renting a home, don't start looking for another home again. Take some time off to heal. Take some time off to get on the same page about money. This situation with the foreclosure should not end your relationship. If anything, you can use it to become a lot closer as a couple, because you have a new foundation to start building from. You know what mistakes you don't want to make again. And when we get broken down like that, if we take the time to just heal, to talk, to be 100% transparent with all the finances in our relationship, and start to get our arms wrapped around our financial relationship, take that time. This does not have to lead to divorce. This can actually strengthen your relationship and actually help you in the future with not only your financial decisions, but your money decisions as well.
One of the things that we found is that this time, when there's a challenging situation like foreclosure, this is the time to come together, learn about each other and how you view money, and understanding your money personalities, which we outline on our website at themoneycouple.com. And also you can get there through the 700 Club website as well. But understanding how each other views money will also help you heal from this situation, but then get on the right path and get together, and making sure that the foundation of your relationship, how you talk about money, is put in place.
All right, the book, First Comes Love, Then Comes Money, it's available at bookstores. It's a couple's guide to financial communication. It's one of the toughest things in a marriage, to be able to meld two different things, two different approaches to handling money. Bethany and Scott, thanks for being with us.
Thanks for having us.
It's great to be here.
All right. Well, when we come back, we've received your inbox questions. Mary writes, my attorney said I should file bankruptcy and foreclose on my home. How do I reconcile this with God? Well, we'll answer that and more right after this.
They say life begins after 40. Unfortunately, so can hot flashes. If you're experiencing hot flashes, night sweats, and other common symptoms of menopause, you can finally get effective relief without resorting to risky hormonal treatments. Introducing Ambrin, a natural breakthrough for managing the common symptoms of menopause. Dramatically effective, yet remarkably safe. Ambrin is clinically proven to help provide relief for hot flashes, mood swings, irritability, low energy, occasional sleeplessness, difficulty concentrating, and other common menopausal symptoms.
Backed by published clinical trials, safety studies, over 30 years of research, and a proven record of customer satisfaction, Ambrin is rapidly becoming America's most trusted choice for natural menopause relief.
Ambrin is so powerful, all you need is just two tiny Ambrin capsules, and get ready to say goodbye to symptoms of menopause. That's it. Ambrin doesn't mask the symptoms like herbal supplements or carry health risks like artificial hormones. Instead, Ambrin was clinically shown to promote your natural hormonal balance.
Ambrin gives your body the support it needs to naturally produce and balance its own hormones.
It's like awakening a fountain of youth within your own body. And now you can try this amazing breakthrough risk-free.
Call now to learn how you can try Ambrin risk-free for 30 days.
There are no automatic monthly shipments, clubs to enroll in, or other strings attached. thousands of women already experienced the liberating effects of Ambaren. And with this risk-free offer, you have nothing to lose except your hot flashes. But this offer will expire soon, so you must call now.
Call 1-800-969-3799.
Well, it's time for your inbox questions. If you've got questions for us, there's a place right on the website where you can ask them. You can also put them into the chat room. Well, Mary writes, I've been advised by my lawyer to file bankruptcy and foreclose on my home. As a Christian, I feel that I have let God down. God instructs us to pay our lenders. How do I reconcile this? Well, Mary, you've got to understand that God himself has declared bankruptcy a couple times. When you look at how he repented that he ever made us and then, you know, wiped out all humanity because all we were thinking about was violence. And then he invested heavily in Israel. And he said, I planted you. You were like a vineyard to me. And what happened? I put a stone wall around you. I protected you. I did everything I knew what to do, and what happened? So, you know, to say, you know, these things aren't supposed to happen to us, well, sometimes they do. And the concept of bankruptcy is actually a concept of forgiveness, that it's okay to not put people in debtor's prison if they can't pay their bills, can't pay their loans, can't pay their debts, and there's a way for them to get a new start in life. And that would be a good thing. And so look at it that way. It's a way for you to get a fresh start and a new start. And it's not something where you've let God down or you've let yourself down, but you get a do-over, a start-over. It's not easy to start over. And bankruptcy is something that we need to look at as sort of a final solution to any kind of credit problem. But just look at it that way and say, okay, I get a fresh start. I get a new start at life and leave it behind and then move forward. Gene writes in, we need to purchase a new car and do household repairs but lack the extra finances. Is it wise to refinance our mortgage in order to have these things done? Gene, I don't believe in refinancing mortgages in order to pay for automobiles. Lifespan of an automobile, even at the, say, the maximum, is about 10 years. For most Americans, it's about 3 to 5. And then you want to get a new one. And if you put that money against your house, you're going to be paying it off over a 30-year period. And so it just doesn't make any sense to pay interest for 30 years on something that is of no value. I do think mortgages as a financial way to own property are a good idea because that property in 30 years it should be worth a whole lot more. So, you know, you're investing in something that's an asset that's growing in value. But putting a consumer debt on your mortgage, putting your vacation on your mortgage, a new car on your mortgage, a remodel on your mortgage, probably not a good idea. Well, nearly 45 million Americans had trouble feeding themselves or their family members at some point last year. Diane and Bill McClintock were among them.
Diane and Bill McClintock were living the American dream. But when Bill's back problems interfered with his work, the dream became a nightmare.
He lost his job, unfortunately. His back has given out on him. He has 14 bulging discs in his back, arthritis through his spine. He has nerve damage. So this man has been a hard worker through our whole 25 years of marriage.
The mounting medical bills and loss of two incomes made it even harder to take care of their grandchildren while their daughter-in-law's at work. Operation Blessing and the Volunteer Way in Newport Richey, Florida, help families like the McClintocks get through this tough economic time.
Operation Blessing helps us because what they do is they help the Volunteer Way by providing food. If we didn't have that organization to help us with food, we wouldn't survive. There would be no way. Without Operation Blessing, without the Volunteer Way, we would not be able to feed ourselves, our grandchildren, and we wouldn't have anything in the cupboard.
The Volunteer Way feeds over 600 families every week in the Tampa Bay area. Lester Seifer is the director.
We've been partnering with Operation Blessing for approximately 12 years. Without Operation Blessing, we would not have food for all these families that we're feeding. I mean, they've been an absolute blessing. Every time we needed something, we call on Operation Blessing. They would be there and they would help.
This is just a moment in time for us. I work. I help raise my grandchildren. I have a very full life. And without people donating to Operation Blessing and the Volunteer Way, I wouldn't be able to say, this is just a moment and tomorrow will be better and I'll be able to help too. And that's the goal, is to receive and to give.
If you want to be a part of Blessing Americans, all you have to do is join the 700 Club. A portion of every gift goes into the work of Operation Blessing. And right here in America, there are many families that have lost their jobs and need help. And it's incredible what can happen when you just give them a bridge to say, okay, we're here for you until you can get back on your feet. Operation Blessing is feeding 3 million Americans every single month. Over 100 million pounds of food delivered every year. And you're a part of it when you join the 700 Club. We're a lot more than just a TV show. We want to reach out with hands of love and compassion to people around the world. So if you want to be a part of it, join with us. Just call the toll-free number on the screen, 888-777-1999, or you can give through the internet. When you call, ask for Pledge Express. That's electronic monthly giving. The bank does all the work. We save so much on the processing. We're able to send monthly teaching CDs to you. So if you want that, ask for Pledge Express. Well, when we come back, a millionaire who lost his family and his fortune, find out how he got back on his feet right after this.
Her story shocked us.
Teenage girl from the North Shore, shark attack.
Her loss touched us.
She will never be the same.
I can't do this anymore.
Her comeback inspired us.
I don't need easy. I just need possible.
Something good is gonna come out of this.
And showed us what it takes to be a true champion. Soul Surfer. Rated PG. Starts tomorrow.
The movie Soul Surfer comes to theaters on Friday and at the 700 Club on Thursday. Go behind the scenes for interviews with the real Bethany Hamilton.
I think God put that determination in my heart, and he knew that I would be able to handle it through him.
Her parents, actor Dennis Quaid, and the film's director.
Bethany shows that not only can you get back up on the board, but you can excel at it.
The 700 Club goes on location in Hawaii. Next.
Doing a great job training her, brother Tom.
Bethany. For all of us who've lost what we care about.
When can I surf again?
Only to discover.
I can't even paddle out past the big waves.
What we love.
It's not going to be easy.
I don't need easy. I just need possible.
No.
The greatest surfers know when the best waves are coming. You have that gift too. Go get them.
Soul Surfer starts tomorrow. Rated PG.
Tom Dimitri was a self-made millionaire. He was determined never to live the way he had been raised, first in the home of a hoarder and then in extreme poverty.
At a young age, my father became ill with schizophrenia.
Growing up, Tom lived with chaos.
My dad was one of those hoarders you hear about, and talk about embarrassment. His yard just became stacked full of junk, washers, dryers, cars, tires. When you would go in the house, it was the same disaster, you know, just stuff piled right to the ceiling. I'm talking to the extreme, mentally ill.
Tom's mother could not cope with her husband's mental illness, so she took her three sons and moved to the projects. For years, the family lived in extreme poverty. By the time he was a teenager, Tom became financially independent. Before he was out of high school, he started working for one of the largest hat companies in the world.
I gave my heart and soul to that company. And I started there when I was 15. I always worked that job. I started sweeping floors, cleaning toilets, cutting grass, those kinds of things, living on my own in an apartment with a friend and paying my own bills. And I was on my own for good at the age of 17. And with all that freedom, you know, I started partying, you know, a lot of drinking. I got into some drugs. So between drugs and the booze and girls, I was running rabid. It was disgusting.
Tom married at the age of 25 and had three daughters, but his family took a back seat to his career. His hard work earned him a promotion to national sales manager of his company.
I became wealthy. I was a millionaire for a time. I traveled the world on the road, you know, 2.5, 3.5 weeks a month, finest restaurants, finest nightclubs, and I was idolizing everything. I was self-centered, always worried about me. I wasn't faithful.
In 2000, Tom was on a business trip when he received a call that his brother had a massive heart attack. Just days later, he died at just 40 years old.
I was really close to him. In all those years, he loved God. He went to church, he read the Bible. He was so trying to get me to get to Jesus, you know? I wanted nothing to do with it. Pete, just cool it, man, stop with all that, you know? He loved God, he never gave up his faith.
1 year after his brother's death, Tom lost his job and most of his money in the stock market. In the same year, his wife filed for a divorce.
I was in deep, deep depression. I lost a job. I lost tons of my wealth to the tune of over probably $1 million. I lost valuable, valuable time with my kids. I lost everything.
One day, shortly after his divorce, Tom thought about the words his brother had always spoken to him. Tom decided to take a walk near his favorite lake.
I didn't know where my life was going, so I'm just saying, Lord, help me, you know? Just cried out, help. I remember looking down at that water. It was real calm and kind of dark. I just said to myself, man, if I just slither down into that water, it'd be a lot more peaceful. Because I'm a quit sin, Lord. All that sin got me to such a low place, I had to surrender to him. I woke up in the morning, and I felt a little better. And I grabbed a Bible, and I opened it to Proverbs, and it got me going.
After reading the Bible, Tom decided to attend a local church.
That's when my life started to turn around, and it was about, I would say, a month after that is when I was in church the one day, and I went up to the altar and I got saved. And nowadays, I give him all the glory. I can't wake up in the morning without prayer and some word to get through another day. My life is coming full circle after the disastrous past that I've had. Thanks to Jesus, I'm peaceful and happy and free, and you know, I've been forgiven. I love God, I love Jesus, I love what he's done for me in my life, and I'm out to glorify him. A lot of you out there, I know you're going through some stuff, man. I've been through it all, man. And I'm saved, and I'm free, and you could be too. There's no doubt. There's no doubt.
There's no doubt. I'm saved, and I'm free. And maybe you're going through stuff. Maybe you're like Tom. Maybe your stuff is caused by things that weren't in your control. That you lost your job, you lost your home, you lost your marriage. What do I do now? And maybe it was not your fault. With Tom, he could say, it was. I'm the one that went out and used drugs and drank, and you know, I thought I had the world by the tail. It's the other way around. Maybe for you, you're wondering, what happened to me? How do I get through this? I've got good news for you. You don't have to walk through life alone. You can walk through life hearing the voice of God. And when you have questions, you can go to him and say, Father, what can I do? What should I do? Bible's very specific that if anyone lacks wisdom, let him ask. Let him ask. Bible's also very specific. It's Jeremiah 33:3. If you want to look it up, I call it God's phone number. Call to me, and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things you do not know. You can ask God for wisdom. You can ask him for direction. You can ask him for what to do. And there's no limit to what you can ask him. And if you just spend time with him on a regular basis, every day, spend time with him and ask him questions, he'll answer. He'll be with you. But it starts with you saying, I want to be born again. Jesus is very specific with this. He's very specific with Nicodemus that unless you're born again, you cannot see the kingdom of heaven. Unless you have that experience with him, that renewal, the Greek word is regenerated. Unless you have that, you can't see, you can't hear, you can't understand. But when you have it, then it becomes plain. God becomes real to you. He opens your eyes. He opens your ears. He gives you a heart of understanding that you can know. And no longer do you have to spend a life of worry and anxiety. What's going to happen? What's the future hold? Where am I going? But you can live a life of peace and happiness and joy. God wants to show himself. God wants to prove himself. God wants to be your father, be your God. He wants to do these things. You don't have to talk him into it. All you have to do is believe and receive. Now, if this is for you, this is what you want, bow your head. Pray a very simple prayer. Let today be the day that you meet Jesus. You don't just hear about him. You don't just hear somebody talk about him. But you meet him, and you know him. He's not some stranger to you, but you know him. So if this is for you, bow your head, pray a prayer. He'll answer. He'll come in. Pray with me. Jesus. That's right. Say it out loud. Jesus. And say it like he's right in the room with you. Jesus. I open my heart. I ask that you come in. And Jesus, I want to be clean. I want to be new. I want you to forgive me. And Jesus, I want you to open my ears that I can hear your voice. I want you to open my eyes that I can see. And I want a heart of understanding that I would know. And Jesus, if you'll do this, I want to follow you all the days of my life. Hear my prayer, for I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, Father, I pray for those who just prayed, and I ask for a revelation of your presence, that your presence would just come over them and be in them, and they would know now that their prayer has been heard and answered. Open their ears so they can hear your voice, and I ask that you would speak to them now and bring them comfort. For we ask it in Jesus' name. If you prayed with me, give us a call and let us know. 888-777-1999. The number's toll free. We leave you this word from Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases.